you know what I would do to get a hold of a Mellotron? I would kill to get a hold of, maybe not kill, I would hurt you to get a hold of a Mellotron. Now, I wouldn't hurt anybody, but I would inconvenience you severely to get a hold of a Mellotron. Let's talk about the Mellotron, or Mellotron, depending the way you look at it. All right, sorry. It first really caught my attention when I watched Beggar's Opera perform Raymond's Road on Beat Club years ago, and Virginia Scott was playing the bass clef notes to accent the toccata in D minor. Obviously, more famous songs have taken the lead, and you might be familiar with the Mellotron from Strawberry Fields Forever and the Moody Blues, heavy usage of the instrument. In the late 1970s, they weren't hip enough for the new synth-loving musicians on the scene, and it was periodically forgotten about until now. But who came up with such a beautiful sounding instrument? Let's flash back to 1950s England, where the Chamberlain was invented by an American man called Harry Chamberlain. The Chamberlain M1 is a very rare instrument to find in 2021, but the idea for the instrument at the time came from Harry Chamberlain himself playing an organ and conceiving its playback as entertainment. Let's look at the Chamberlain as being a sort of seed that sprouted into the flower that is the Mellotron. The first Chamberlain was technically designed in 1948, but was designed for a home entertainment device for sing-alongs while playing big band standards of the day. The idea of it being used for rock and roll was definitely not intended by Harry Chamberlain, because it is said that he actually disliked rock and roll music at the time. The Chamberlain is worth making a separate video about, but it really is the base idea for the Mellotron, as the Mellotron, just like the Chamberlain, uses a piano-style keyboard that has a tape-playing mechanism connected behind each note. But this wasn't something he just came up with off the cuff. He actually had to spend 15 grueling years of trial and error to make this thing work, and like a plant that needs water, Chamberlain needed a bit of synergy to get the Mellotron off the ground. This synergy consisted of the following people. In 1962, one of Harry's salesmen, Bill Franson, came to England to partner up with Harry to figure out one of the most difficult bits, the playback heads for the machine. Bill stumbled on Les Bradley, who fell in love with the Chamberlain, and he was completely knocked out by it. So much so, he couldn't fall asleep that night, according to Les's grandson. That's when they stumbled on Eric Robinson and David Nixon. The first few models of the Mellotron were also designed to be used in the home, containing various sounds. Eric Robinson, a conductor and presenter of music for the BBC who served in the Royal Army Ordnance Corps, was heavily involved in the financial support and backing for the Mellotron, as well as David Nixon, who was a magician and TV personality, and at one point the best-known magician in the UK, who were the two people behind the introduction and promotion of the Mellotron instruments. Even Princess Margaret herself was an early adopter who paid £1,000 for one at the time. This is when the seed of the Mellotron really got to flourish into the plant it's always destined to be. David Nixon and Eric Robinson spotted a musician called Jeff Unwin, who also helped its promotion after Pathé filmed a 10-minute promotional video where he played the instrument and appeared on the children's TV show Blue Peter, where he demonstrated the Mellotron. So, out of Chamberlain, Mellotron was born, with the synergy of all these people combined. The Mellotron, essentially, at the time, was a one-man band. Fun for families, kids, parties. You could sing and dance to it without even having to hire a band at your home. It's got 70 tapes, and when you press the key, it drives and pulls the tape out of a storage loop, which is spring-loaded. It's such a crazy idea that the strings of a piano were replaced with tapes, and the hammer was replaced with a tape head. The Mellotron truly was a giant step for musician kind, as it was really, considering the tape that is accessed by keys, the first sampler ever made. It really is the original sampler. If the Fairlight CMI is the mother of all samplers, then the Mellotron is definitely the father of all samplers. Mellotronic started recognizing how rock and roll musicians started recognizing the Mellotron. Enter progressive rock. You might even argue that the very key or beating heart of progressive rock was the Mellotron. The Mellotron is used in progressive masterpieces as it could produce entire orchestras, but there was one major issue. It was a nightmare to transport a Mellotron. Hot, sweaty gigs and Mellotronics just did not go together. The Mellotron is extremely temperature sensitive, and the tapes absolutely hated the heat, and moisture too. looks like we have something in common. So you'd hear the pitch drifting, and there was nothing you could do about it, which was only worse on delicate instruments such as the flute. Once the note started shifting, it just got worse and worse, and it went downhill from there. But aside from the difficulty it faced during live gigs, that was not the case for recordings. The Moody Blues described getting chills all the way up their spine when they added the Mellotron to Nights in White Satin. The Moodies played support to the Beatles in 1966, and that turned on the Beatles to the Mellotron. Manfred Mann was also a major user of the Mellotron, who said he tried to use it as much as he could. Ha ha, said the clown, was 90% Mellotron. Bowie's Space Oddity, of course, and Brian Auger and the Trinity loved using the Mellotron. Oh, well, let's not forget King Crimson. The Mellotron was capable of much more, though, because the famous Spanish guitar intro to Bungalow Bill was also played by a certain Mr. Mellotron. Oh, and let's not forget Earth and Fire, which is an epic Dutch band that prominently used the Mellotron. One of my favorites, definitely check them out. Each tape, or each key, is pre-recorded with different special effects and musical instruments. The roller mechanism of the Chamberlain receives the tape through a pressure pad pushing the tape head and a pinch roller beneath the key, pulling it forward into the mechanism. The Mellotron pushes a length of magnetic tape against the capstan, which then pulls it across a playback head. When the key is released, the tape is retracted by a spring to go back into its original position. And different portions of the tape produce different types of sounds. But each tape is only a few seconds long, and if you press the key until the tape runs out, well, you get no sound. As with a lot of synthesizers and keyboards, and proto-samplers like the Mellotron, the Musicians Union was convinced that an instrument that is able to replicate the presence of an entire orchestra would put musicians out of business. As Edgar Fraser of the Tangerine Dream said, prior to their 1975 gig, somebody showed up asking for a couple of thousand pounds to compensate for using the Mellotron. Unbelievable. In 1977, the Mellotronics company was donezo when synthesizers were introduced. There was also a toy keyboard produced by Mattel called the Optigon in 1975, which was much smaller and could be used in the home for entertainment purposes. Although this wasn't necessarily the reason the Mellotronics company ended, but it certainly didn't help anything either. I hope you enjoyed this little book report. If anyone has one of these magical machines, please feel free to send us an email, if you're selling it. I will see you next time.